Everyone, welcome. Thank you for coming. I have a few announcements before we begin. First of all, if you could please silence your cell phones. Don't turn them off because we encourage tweeting with the hashtag #IstStartup. After the session, there will be a short Q&A. So if you have any questions, you can just raise your hand and ask, or you can tweet them to #IstStartup, or you can text them to the number on the board, 37607, your question and #IstStartup. John Kim is the founder of the cloud software company Five9, which raised over $80 million in venture capital and is widely recognized as the leading company in that space. He has also acted as an advisor to numerous venture capital-funded startups. He currently serves as the CEO of the mobile healthcare company DrBase.com. And now please join me in welcoming John Kim.
All right, well, thank you for showing up. You know, I went to Penn State during the 90s and there was no College of IST. I had to kind of make up my own major. I loved chemistry and I loved to read. So I majored in liberal studies, which is like an amorphous degree, like, but it allowed me to graduate. You know, 13 years ago, I left here to move to San Francisco to pursue my startup dreams. And you know, it's amazing to come back and see the amount of institutionalized support there is for people that want to go into tech or want to be entrepreneurs. You know, I've done about 100 of these conferences, and what I haven't seen is a presentation that gave a kind of step-by-step guide on how to raise money for your idea, right? So most of you will probably have amazing corporate jobs. About a quarter of you, after working for a few years for Facebook or Google, will decide to actually do your own startup. It's a natural evolution for a lot of folks. But raising money is really hard, right? You're asking a stranger to give you hundreds of thousands, millions, tens of millions of dollars, right? And often, that comes down to your presentation, right? So in 7 steps, I'm going to show you what I learned in 13 years in an hour. And with this template, you guys should have a good chance of raising money when you guys, if you guys decide to. All right? As you can tell, I love motorcycles. All right. So when I came out to San Francisco, this was my 2004 compact Presario laptop. I had 6 credit cards, which I maxed out. This thing, and an apartment in San Francisco, right? So it's amazing what a humble beginning can look like in the end. And I'll show you a happy ending at the end. The first step is to figure out what you want, right? If you look at me and my little brother, my younger brother is a director level IT person in a large company. He's 38 years old, makes tons of money. But you know, every time we meet, he says, you know, I wish I could go back in time and actually do something of my own. And so I think the first step is to figure out who you are. If you have a little bit of inkling of not wanting to work for somebody else, if you have a little bit of an inkling that you might want to be in a bar, restaurant, cocktail party, and you want someone to say like, oh, I use your app, I love it. There's a good chance that when you're my age, you'll have some type of midlife crisis, and you will have wished that you created your own startup. But being 30-something, making a few $100,000 a year, working in a big company, there's nothing wrong with that, right? And there's nothing wrong with being an entrepreneur. You just have to figure out where you want to end up, right? So it's something to think about. You guys have time, and even when you enter grade, you work for PNC Bank, after graduation, you'll have a few years to figure it out, right? One thing I do want to warn you guys about, though, and this is one of the common mistakes I see young entrepreneurs make. You cannot have it both. You can't have it both. a lot of people want to have a cushy job, and then they have a startup on the side, and when that side thing blows up, they're going to just slide in, tell their boss to go F themselves, and land into this new app that's just exploded, right? Doesn't happen. It just, not saying that it can't, I've never, ever seen it happen, right? So at some point, like riding a bike, you gotta commit, right? All right, so you figured out that you wanna be an entrepreneur someday. These are the terms that you should know. If you don't know all six of these terms, no one's gonna take you seriously. Even the mildly sophisticated investors will not take you seriously, all right? So let's go over each of these terms one by one because they're not hard to understand, right? But you guys aren't in the Smeal College, right? And these are pretty sophisticated later stage class terms, even if you were at Smeal, okay? But you'll see they're not hard to understand once we go through them. So one is called the TAM, or the total addressable market, okay? So the total addressable market is, for example, let's say we created a restaurant software IT company together, and it was about digital receipts. Didn't have to print out paper receipts anymore. And say in America, I'm making this number up, but let's say in America there's 1 million restaurants, and we're gonna charge each restaurant $10 a month, right? So you add that up, what do you have? The total addressable market, right, is like $120 million annually, okay? You have to figure out what the TAM is, because no matter how good your idea, if the total addressable market isn't $1 billion or more, right, sophisticated investors, and I mean sophisticated outside your friends and family, will not want to invest in it. And it used to be when I was your age starting out, the minimum TAM was $1 billion. Now it's closer to about $2 billion, okay? So by the time you guys graduate, you're in the workplace for a few years, you want to figure out an idea that has a total addressable market of at least $2 billion, right? Okay. Your 12-month minimal viable product, or your MVP. You guys are probably all aware about of this term, right? It can't be done in a semester. Even if you created Snapchat in a semester, I assure you it's gonna take another semester and a summer to work out all the bugs, reconfigure the UX, right? Figure out how the architecture scales on the back end if you get more than 50 users, right? One thing that you guys are probably aware of is when you build something, 50 users has different bugs than 500 users, and 5,000 users will present all new types of bugs than when you're at 5 million users, right? Okay, so don't think you can build this in a semester, right? Monthly recurring revenue, or MRR. It used to be that when I was a kid, companies sold really expensive software licenses, right? Like Oracle, Siebel, Microsoft Enterprise, sold multi-million dollar software solutions. Now everything is, I hate this word, but in the cloud. And companies, your company likely, will charge on a monthly subscription basis. So the way investors measure how much money you're gonna make is on a monthly subscription basis, like a magazine. And it's called MRR, monthly recurring revenue, okay? That monthly recurring revenue should be growing each month, but you know, the one trap I see a lot of young entrepreneurs make about predicting their MRR to an investor is that they make the wrong assumption about what customers will pay. So, a few years ago, I actually had lunch with the CEO of LeapFrog. And you guys aren't parents, so you probably don't know what LeapFrog is. But LeapFrog is a publicly traded company that makes learning toys and books for kids, like talking books. And when Mike was first starting out, his first product were these letters that you could squeeze, A through Z. And when you squeezed it, it would make the sound of a letter, right? So he spent $30,000, got what's called a focus group. Right? The internet has mostly gotten rid of focus groups, but he had a focus group, And he watched through a one-way mirror these parents and their children playing with these letters, right? And the kids were squeezing the letters. It was making all sorts of sounds. And they loved it. And so Mike looked at his partner, and they high-fived each other. And they said, "We're rich. We did it." And then at the end, the moderator asked them, "How much would you be willing to pay for this?" Now, each letter, right, cost $10 to make, because there's a piece of electronic, there's a little speaker. And they said, "How many of you would pay $200 for this?" No one raised their hand. That's what it costs to make them, right? $100, $80. It turns out the magic price was $35. That was a tough lesson, right? He went to China, he got these things manufactured, he had a focus group, right? Don't assume what customers will pay in building your MRR, right? Getting that right is really key in convincing an investor that you can build out your revenue model, right? So as you build all these assumptions, look, investors know that you're making it up, but you have to have at least a degree of sophistication about that, right? So now you know, don't assume. Okay, CAC, your customer acquisition cost. And one of the teams that was really brave went through their pitch at the mHealth competition. By the way, for those that were there, you guys did an amazing job. But one of the ideas had a severe flaw, right? It said, this idea is going to work when we have tons of people uploading their files to our cloud. But there's a thing called CAC, right? So if you sell to restaurants software that costs $10 a month, what's it going to cost us, our startup, to acquire that restaurant? Because we're going to have to hire someone. They're going to have to go door to door. We're going to have to do Google AdWords. We're going to have to do PR. It could be, and this happens to many, many businesses. In fact, this happens to most startups. And this is where most startup ideas that are actually good freaking ideas fail because the CAC math does not add up. So let's say it takes us $200 in commission to the sales rep and another $1,000 in marketing to get that restaurant. So it costs us $1,200 to acquire a customer. That's going to pay us $120 a year. It's a good idea. The customers want it. They'll buy it. But it just costs too much money to acquire that customer for our startup idea, right? So you have to know what CAC is. And by the way, if you guys ever do pitch a few years from now, you're in a venture capital firm in Silicon Valley and you know these terms cold, you'll gain their respect and you'll kind of be allowed to mentally move to the next phase, right? So these are really important to know. LTV, long-term value of a customer. Did you guys know, I mean, this is a OSU study, right? So I take it with a grain of salt when it's from a Buckeye, but according to an OSU study, 57% of restaurants fail within the first 3 years, right? So as you're building your projections for investors, you have to know what the LTV is. Right? So for us, our average restaurant customer may only pay us for 36 months, and then you have to assume that a certain portion of them are going to go out of business, right? Okay, important to know your LTV. In my first startup, 80% of our customers went out of business. We sold cloud software to call centers. That was rough. 80% of your customers go out of business. In my current startup, DoctorBase, our customers are doctors. Almost none of them go out of business, right? So, you know, I learned the hard way. LTV is very important, and it will and it should dictate who your customers are, all right? So now you're starting to see our brilliant idea is not so freaking brilliant, right? It can be once we massage it, knowing the factors that can get it funded and actually turn it into a sustainable business, all right? And then 12-month P&L, you'll hear this a lot, your profit and loss. Whatever it is, discount it by 35%. And just tell the investors, hey, listen, here are my original projections. I discounted it 35% for reality, and they'll respect you. All right, step three. Give a presentation together, right? You want to have really dense slides. I've seen people pitch me with 25, 30 slide decks. You're going to lose them, right? You want something that kind of fascinates them and keeps their attention, like this meme did to me. You don't need a large deck for your first round of funding. It's 15 pages max, 10 preferable, right? And I won't go through all these, but here's some of the key slides, right? Team, problem you're solving, your solution, 12-month P&L, as I discussed, your defensible barriers to entry. Now, when you first pitch, your first half a dozen times, some jackass is going to be like, well, do you have a patent on that? What are your defensible barriers to entry? And the truth is, there really are none. You know, they're going to ask it anyway. It's not something that, I mean, Google probably got the same question, right? There were tons of search engines before Google, right? You're going to get that question. Don't pay it any attention. Don't let it throw you, but you are going to get it. Traction in the market. That means, do you have any early stage customers, which is always great to have, even if it's a few or a couple. Your key milestones, you guys quit your jobs, that's one. And then what you're going to do with the money, right? Okay. You are going to give a demo, and the demo is always going to end up being the meat of the presentation, right? So you want to give a great demo. One of my favorite examples of a 15-slide deck, which again is the biggest your deck should be, is done by Mint. Do you guys know Mint.com? Yeah? Okay. So this is Aaron Patzer's slide before he raised money. 15 slides. Did very, very well. I'll show you an example of what I like, though. And there's you can go either flavor. I like 5-slide decks. So when I was a co-founder of this startup, my second startup out of three, this deck was 5 slides. We raised $2 million in 2 weeks. Okay, so it doesn't have to be a long deck. In fact, with a long deck, you're going to lose your investors' attention in about slide 6 or slide 7 anyway, right? So to have dense decks, right, where here we talked about the customers, our financials, the opportunity, our technology, and our team all in one slide. I've seen people stretch this out into 6, 5 slides, right? You don't need to do that. You have dense slides. I've seen people stretch this out into 5 slides. Why? You can have one slide, right? People get images. People pay more attention to images. All right. Step four, where to pitch. So it turns out VCs don't take cold pitches. Like, you cannot email Sequoia and say, hey, I've got a great idea. You have to know someone that will give you an introduction, right? And for the best and brightest of the IST, I've told your professor that I don't mind if she vouches for you, giving you an introduction to the VC firms out in Silicon Valley. But you need an introduction, right? You cannot cold email them. But there are crowdfunding sites that are growing in popularity, like Angel.co. Do you guys know about Angel.co? Yeah? No? If you guys want to be smarter than all the other kids at IST and know what the hot tech startups are, subscribe to Angel.co. It keeps track of all the hot startups that the trendy investors are putting their money into. It should also give you a lot of ideas for what you may want to ultimately be interested in as well. Okay? Angel.co. And you can be the featured company in a what's like a one-day rush, right? So they have a daily email that goes out to almost every famous investor, right? Dave McClure, Eric Schmidt of Google, Mark Zuckerberg. They all subscribe to Angel.co's daily newsletter. Okay? So being the featured company, can you imagine in that one daily email, you are the featured company, right? It's going to be a mad rush. And places like here, you can pitch. You can cold email them, pitch your idea, and you might be the featured company of the day. LinkedIn InMail. You guys probably haven't used this, but you can cold email someone. So you wouldn't cold email a VC firm, but if you really feel like a particular firm or investor would get you, right? You can find them on LinkedIn. It's going to cost you $10, but you can send them what's called an InMail. Right? And this actually is how LinkedIn makes a lot of money, right? Because it's like sending them a FedEx digitally. It doesn't cost them anything. Brilliant idea. And then you can enter pitch and demo competitions. I can't tell you how many times I've seen a startup gain access to an amazingly difficult VC firm to penetrate by simply saying, I want a pitch competition, like the one that some of the folks here won at the mHealth competition, right? They could legitimately use that to say, I want a pitch competition at Penn State's IST, and I'd like to talk to you about my idea. Instant credibility, right? All right, so for DoctorBase, this is what our angel.co featured company of the day email looked like to investors. And this 87 characters raised $1 million in 8 hours, right? By the way, I should mention that I did not have the highest GPA at Penn State, so if I can do it, trust me, you guys can do it, all right? Step five, what do you say in your email intro? And this is a really common mistake I see young entrepreneurs make, because we're excited, right? And so you send John Doe VC an email that says, introducing the newest way to find a travel deal, right? Hi, John, I know you don't know me. And again, realize that in their inbox, it probably cuts off at right after but. I know you don't know me, but you think he's going to open your freaking email, right? And this is, even if he or she did, this is what it would sound like to her, right? So I'm not immune to that. My first VC pitch, I actually wore, I wore this t-shirt. It was to a firm called Greylock, a multi-billion dollar, very institutionalized blue blood firm in Boston. And I sat up here like now, being a complete jackass hype monkey, right? And this is what the back of my t-shirt says, right? In telecom or the call center business, I couldn't even figure out what my customer base was, right? It was either telecom or the call center business, right? Our software can save your company money and add to your bottom line now, all caps, right? And I wasted money on a freaking vanity 800 number. And I couldn't even get the 800 number, so it was an 866, right? In the middle of my pitch, one of the partners said, whoa, kid, cut the fucking hype. And the one thing you guys will realize if you start pitching is VCs are really curt, right? There's a famous VC named Dave McClure. I've literally heard him tell young entrepreneurs like yourselves in the middle of a pitch to a crowded room of 400 or 500 people at Microsoft. I've heard him say, kid, what the fuck do you do, right? Sorry, I don't mean to curse, I'm just quoting him, right? So how do you pitch? You don't have to use this one, but this is an example. All right, you want to capture their attention? I'm showing you all my dirty tricks. RE, right, colon, it sounds like, it looks like, you're responding to a previous. Why are you nodding? Do you do this all the time?
I mean, yeah.
So don't do it to me. Right. So if this is a certain VC firm and you know that they've invested in group travel or group deal sites like Groupon, Living Social, right? Instead of some hypey, self-indulgent statement about your startup idea, right? This says, are group travel deals getting traction with consumers? VCs love information. And in the information age, a lot of a VC's value, right, is knowing information that isn't on the web, right? So the rest of this says, hi John, with so much buzz about group purchasing, our company has been quietly amassing data sets on how consumers are actually buying group travel deals, how quickly they buy, the tipping point, and a few other emerging trends we've spotted that I think might be of interest to Excel partners. Giant firm, given that you've already invested in Groupon and Living Social. Now, what are the chances that this VC that has $100 million invested in two different group buying sites sees this email that says you have data that's not anywhere else on the web that you could give them? What are the chances they're going to respond to this email? It's not a guarantee, but it's a hell of a lot better than my t-shirt, right? Okay. Step six, you want to nail the demo, as I mentioned before, right? This is where so many great startups flop, because the demo is something that's almost a mental sand trap, right? If you get too into the weeds in your demo because you're showing them every little feature, you're going to lose them at around the sixth, seventh click, right? So you got to think about that. Around six or seven clicks, you're going to start losing a certain percentage of the room, right? Don't get too granular. You don't need to show them every feature in your new product. You got to pick three. Pick three. So the rule of demos that I found is that if you show them three features, they'll remember none. If you show them two, they'll remember one. I don't know why that is. It just is, especially in a pitch competition, right? But that's also true when you walk into a VC's conference room, it's 2 p.m. How many other pitches do you think they've seen that day, right? Show them three features, they'll remember none. Show them two, they'll remember one, right? And if at some point you're not saying, and it's that easy, and I know it sounds fucking cheesy, right? But at some point, if you're not at least thinking or showing or saying, and it's that easy, you might want to rethink the simplicity of the demo you're giving. The greatest demos are amazingly simple, right? Videotape yourself, practice, practice, practice. I know no one likes to hear the sound of your own voice, especially me. Just got to get through it. And then what I like is the mom test, right? My mom is a Korean immigrant. She's 70 years old. God bless her. She has an iPad and an iPhone. She still doesn't know what I do. But you know, the mom test is great because if your mom can understand what you do, just on a 10,000 foot level, right, chances are you've gotten a good elevator pitch, right? Everyone know what an elevator pitch is? Yeah? Okay. All right. So here's my dirty trick to giving a great demo, is you have one of your first customers come with you and co-give the demo for you. It gives you instant credibility, right? They associate someone paying. Hey, they love this. They're using it. And now your investor can imagine thousands more like this guy using it, right? So you guys are too young to remember this, but Maureen May, we're a similar generation. Hair Club for Men. It's this guy that sold, I don't know what the hell it was. It was like a toupee or something, right? But at the end, he would say, and I'm not just a member, I'm a customer, right? Dirty trick to giving a great demo, have your customer give the demo, even if it's your first customer, right? It's just an easy, easy, dirty trick, right? Poor guy has a, I don't know what that is. It looks like a poodle. Yeah. All right, step seven. And that's an actual picture of me when I was three. Know how to follow up, right? A lot of VCs will tell you no or simply won't reply. Don't be a wussy and just take a no lying down. Part of what they want to see is that you won't take no for an answer. They want to see that you have the metal to follow up, right? Until they tell you, like, stop freaking emailing me. Stop calling me. Bother the hell out of them, right? They want to see that you'll earn their respect. Know your pre-money valuation, right? So let's say you get past all this. The investor likes it. You could tell they're thinking about investing. And they say, so what do you think you're worth, right? Know your pre-money valuation. Your pre-money valuation is how much you think you're worth before you take their money, right? So just to give you an example, my first company had a $5 million pre-money valuation, and I raised $5 million. So our post-money valuation was 10. Know the difference. I know some of my VC friends, if they see this, hopefully they don't, aren't going to like me saying this, but have a high pre-money valuation because it is going to be negotiated down. And quite frankly, the higher you think your pre-money valuation is, right, the more respectful it will be. Okay? Know your worth, right? You guys ever go on a date with someone that was like pretty or good looking? And then they thought, they're like, oh, I'm not that pretty, or like, oh, I don't know, I kind of slouch. And then suddenly they're not as hot, right? Be hot, have a high pre-money valuation, right? Okay, it is gonna be negotiated down, it's all right. Okay, define the milestones money will get you to, right? So always have a plan. We're going to hire more engineers. We're going to be doing marketing. We need office furniture. We need computers. All of that's fair game. But just have a mental list because they're going to ask you. And you want to be able to rattle it off, right? Okay. Discuss your exit strategy. Most likely it is not an IPO. Most likely it is not an IPO. Most likely companies get acquired. Successful companies get acquired. There is nothing wrong with getting acquired. You will be a multimillionaire. You'll walk into any job that you want. I mean, literally, if you sell a company in Silicon Valley or San Francisco, and probably in lots of other parts of the world, you can call Facebook and say, hey, I've decided to work here. Really? Really? You know, Penn State Sciences especially has such a great reputation on the East Coast. But when I went out to Silicon Valley, it's full of Harvard, Princeton, MIT, Caltech. You know, at first I had a bit of an inferiority complex, but you know, I realized it's, at the end of the day, not about where you went to school. Certainly it is about what you've learned at school, right? But anyone, whether it's in Philly, Happy Valley, New York, you guys can create your own startup if you want to. Believe me, if I did it, you guys can do it, right? But know your exit strategy, right? Because when you exit, it will be like your Harvard MBA and your Princeton degree and your IST degree all rolled up into one on steroids, right? There's nothing wrong with selling your company and getting acquired. But be able to say that to your investor. This is my exit strategy. At this dollar amount, I want to sell. And typically, if you're going to a smaller angel investor, right, they're a small firm, they'll be happy with 3 to 5 times their money back within 3 years. Okay? So when you're coming up with your exit strategy number, right, just think about that, because that's what they're thinking. It's like, am I going to get 3 to 5 times my money back in a few years? If you go to a big firm, like in the example we used before, XO Venture Partners, they're going to want 10 to 20 times their money back in 5 years, right? So again, when you tell, and you're not going to know, you're making it up, right? But at least they know you're sophisticated enough in the game to know that they know, and they will know that you know, right? So understand that number when you discuss your exit strategy. Know the difference between common and preferred. I won't get too into the weeds in this because this can get complicated, but VCs give themselves a different class of stock than us. It's called preferred shares. And preferred shares is a form of debt, which means if everything goes to hell in a handbasket and you have to scrap the company and sell off the assets, the debt holders get their money back first in this country and many others, right? So they classify their shares differently. It's preferred shares. You guys will own your company still, or a portion of it, but you guys will own it as common shares. And there's all sorts of things that VCs get in their favor as well. A preferred share could have 10 votes. Your common share can have one vote. So think about that. You own 50% of the shares as common. The VC owns 50% of the shares as preferred. 10 votes per share, one vote per share. Who do you think controls the company? Right? You want to know that, and you want to negotiate that. Again, don't be afraid to negotiate these things. They'll respect you for it. Right? It shows that you're sophisticated. It also shows that you're a good negotiator. And when you go to negotiate big customers, they want to see this, right? Don't be afraid to negotiate this stuff. And the most common mistake I see people make, especially with friends and family, please don't do this. You do a convertible note. You do a convertible note because you get some jackass lawyer that doesn't really do securities law, and he says, oh, I got a convertible note, it's only gonna cost you a couple $1,000. You go to Uncle Harry, or whoever it is, your rich aunt, they give you $100,000. And what the convertible note says is, when you get a large round of financing, my loan to you will convert into shares. But here's a problem with that. Your rich aunt likely is not that rich. I hope she is. But if she's not, what's going to happen is you're going to use her $100,000 to grow your startup. You're going to get venture capital financing for, say, $5 million, valuing the company at $5 million pre, $10 million post, right, as per our earlier math. And her shares are going to convert at what? She's going to own $100,000 of $5 million, right? It's not really fair to Aunt Sally, who was like the first person to put in money and help you get off your feet, right? Don't do a convertible note. There's something called a Series Seed. You guys have my email address. If you guys get serious, feel free to email me and I can forward you some documents or some links that give you a better, fair to Aunt Sally alternative, okay? And then the final thing is, and your professor asked me to talk about this, even though I cry inside a little bit when I think about it. I'm kidding, I've never cried. unless I hurt myself. You know, I started a company that would end up being worth $520 million. And I was fired from it. Control is everything. Control is everything. It's more important than the money, right? Because God forbid what happens when your company is successful and you don't control it, right? We are all at-will employees, okay? And at-will basically is a fancy term to say you can be freaking fired at any time, right? Even from your own company. Right? So people would always say, like, my God, you were the CEO. How could they? It's your company. I'm like, See, when you go through a class like this, you understand it's actually not yours anymore, right? Okay. Last thing, and I think this is important, so I added it as the last step. These are the common things not to say. Don't ever, 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 never, ever say these things, because these are immediate red flags to an investor and they will just shut down, okay? Any one of these statements, right? It's a crowded market, but Cisco sucks, right? That's why I'm doing it. Those routers, they freaking suck. I can have a better one. The reason why investors don't like that is, to them, they don't care if it sucks or not. It's making money. So the fact that you're focusing on how much Microsoft sucks, they don't care. Microsoft's making money. You're not. Don't say that. All right. Second, my technical co-founder, my CTO, is a genius. He's a genius. We're all geniuses, right? Every CTO is a genius, right? That is not a competitive differentiator, right? In fact, you know, blue-collar guys like me came out of Penn State. You go to Silicon Valley, you cannot say that. You have to prove that you're a genius by being hardworking, by being grittier, more creative, right? Don't say your CTO's a genius. We have low operating costs. I can't tell you how many times startups have come up to me and said, yeah, but you know what? We're living on ramen. You know, we're working out of my parents' garage. We have low operating costs. You know. The thing is, once you get money, you have to spend it. So my first round of financing, $5 million, it was designed to last, could anyone guess? 12 months, yeah. It's designed to last you 12 to 18 months. You raise $20 million, 12 to 18 months. $5 million, 12 to 18 months. $50 million, 12 to 18 months. You have to spend the money. You will have board meetings and you will get fired if you don't spend the money. So the idea that you guys are living on the cheap now does not matter to them. In fact, that makes you sound like an amateur. Because they're thinking, wait a minute, you know you're gonna have to spend a lot of money very wisely in a short amount of time, right? All right, it's going to go viral. I don't need to explain that, right? All right, we just need money to do some marketing. The fallacy of this is you guys could whip out a credit card right now and for $1,500, you guys could figure out how much it's gonna cost to acquire a customer, right? You guys all know how to build a quick landing page. You throw out some pay-per-click campaigns on Google, you get 100 clicks. Out of that 100 clicks, you get 10 people to fill out a form. You call all 10 people and one of them says, yeah, I would buy that, right? And so how much did you spend to get one person to say they would buy that? So you know your CAC, your customer acquisition cost, right? Instead of saying we just need some money to do marketing, it's better to say, if you gave me $2 million, since my CAC cost is $1,000 per customer, I would get 2,000 customers. That's what I'm gonna do with your money. I'm gonna get 2,000 customers, right? Once it gets traction, don't say that. I don't need to explain that either, right? Okay, we have the secret sauce. We have the magic black box. We have the magic formula, right? We've hit upon, so many people say that, and it just shuts investors down, right? Now, I was in the speaker's conference room when I heard someone say this to another student here yesterday. I don't want to talk too much about my idea. I assure you, no one cares about your stupid idea, okay? Was it Einstein that said, genius is 1% inspiration, 99% perspiration, right? VCs have another form of that cliche, which is to say, it is all about execution, not the idea. If you say, I don't want to tell you about my idea yet, it is a keystone sign of an amateur. Don't say that. No one cares about your stupid idea. It's about execution, all right? All right, so here's the happy ending. My first company last Friday had an IPO on the NASDAQ stock market. This is what it looked like. It was not the happy ending you were thinking about. I don't know why your mind thinks like that, Kristen. Sorry, this is my girlfriend. She came with me. Thank you, babe. So this is my email address. If you'd like, write it down, and I offer this to students of your professors. By the way, do you guys know how lucky you are to have this professor? I know not all of you are in her class. For her students, you are welcome to hit me up and ask me for one favor. All right? All right, questions? Yes.
So in your last slide, you mentioned that I don't want to reveal ideas as a bad thing, but what about the strategy to execute that idea? Is that acceptable to not reveal that, or should you reveal that?
The strategy to execute the idea. The problem with that, okay, so yeah, I'm sorry, give me your name.
Mian.
Mian asked, so you don't want to talk, you want to talk about your idea, but do you want to talk about how you're going to execute on it? You know, that's a really good question. You may not want to. You may want to keep that a secret, actually. But the truth is, have you heard of the word pivot in a startup? So it's very rare that startups go from here to their final end goal in a straight line. It more looks like this, right? So likely your strategy is going to change. But great question. I wouldn't discuss that. Yeah, great question.
If you were a pitch with a venture capitalist, would you say the acronyms given, MVP, CAC, or would you say?
Use the acronyms. Okay. They all use acronyms. Yeah. So you show up there in San Jose or on Sand Hill. Do you guys know what Sand Hill Road is? There is a Rodeo Drive of VC firms, and many, many of them are on the same street called Sand Hill Road by Stanford. And you know, personally, whenever I drive past that exit that says Sand Hill Road, it's like driving past your ex's house, you know? Because I've been rejected so many times on Sand Hill Road before I finally got to a yes, right? Yeah. But when you arrive on Sand Hill Road, always use the acronyms they're using, and they all use mostly acronyms, right? Good question. The question was, should you use acronyms like customer acquisition cost, CAC, or should you actually say customer acquisition cost? Use the acronym. Any other questions? All right, you guys were easy.
We have a question from our online audience. If you could go back in your career and do one thing differently, what would it be?
So the question is, if I could go back in my career, what would I do differently? I wouldn't step off the board of directors of your own company. This is probably the most important lesson I can teach you guys. And in fact, 10 years from now, when you guys are funded with your own business, if I could prevent one of you guys from stepping off the board of your own company, we won't know each other, but God will smile on me. I stepped off the board of my first company, which is how I got fired. I thought the board of directors meetings every month where it's like, you know, I was in my late 20s. I thought it was really a meeting of older douchebags that came, really talk business and chars and, you know, ask questions like, you know, how come we don't have any bagels today, you know? I was like, oh, I'm more of a creative type. And, you know, first of all, you know, when you're in your late 20s, you're like, I'm never going to get old like those guys, right? So I'm totally different. Would never sell out, whatever that means. You know, you're driving to your office in your sports car, and you're like, I'm not going to sell out. And you don't want to go through the pains of being on the board. Because honestly, board meetings are once a month or once a quarter where your investors come and screw a screwdriver through your ear, right? Because it's like, well, how come this person isn't executing? You got to fire that person. How come you didn't hit your MRR, your monthly recurring revenue number? You got two more quarters, John. You got to hit that freaking number, right? And so after every board meeting, you're like, oh my God, I don't want to go through that again. I'm going to hire someone, an old dude, an old bald dude, right, to do that for me. And then I'm going to like be the cool, liked guy that wears shorts to work. That's going to be me, and Birkenstocks. It turns out that in raising a puppy, hopefully a multi-$100 million puppy, you have to clean up its poop, right? You got to train it, right? If it gets sick, you got to drive it to the vet at night. You can't offload those things to somebody else. It's your puppy. You gotta attend the board meetings. Do not step off the board of directors. A lot of you, when your companies are successful, because you guys are first-time CEOs, you will not be the CEO. That's fine. That's fine. But don't step off the board of directors. All right? Okay. Yes?
Just one more question. You were talking about how the VCs don't like taking cold pitches, so they don't. What is the best way to get that introduction? Like, what strategies would you recommend for that?
So the question was, because VCs don't take cold pitches or cold introductions, what is the best way to get introduced to them? Honestly, it's about networking. It's about being in classes like this, having professors like Professor Irene. She heavily canvassed me to be a bridge for her best and brightest students to get introductions to Silicon Valley VCs, of which I said yes. So you have your introduction. But this honestly, just kind of real life networking and being at the right place at the right time, having the right professor, having the right friends, that's how you do it. Yeah. You guys are lucky. Yes?
I'm trying to keep it on topic. Last night we were discussing how there's such a shortage of talent that certain companies are looking to extend visas and get other talent. Are the skill sets that are in demand that are in shortage equivalent in the larger companies, are the same skill sets relevant to startups?
Right. Great question. So the question was, are the large companies like Google and Facebook, who are so desperate to hire young talent, hiring for the same kinds of roles or capacities that a startup would? And absolutely, yes. So as IST students, you guys don't have to be programmers. You can be technical, you can be project leads, you can be product managers, you can be user interface designers, right? You can be the back-end architect of a system. You could be the marketer. A lot of people don't know this, but marketing today is a highly technical position. You're running multiple consoles, analytics. You're managing more money now than the IT person is, right? So you are in a highly analytical, technical role. If you're in marketing in a startup or at Facebook or Google, you are likely doing lots of interactions with engineers and asking them to build certain things, right? So the fact that a lot of these companies get, do you guys know what an acqui-hire is? You guys are living at a great time for technology, for young people in technology. The larger tech companies in the Bay Area and even New York, and I imagine in places like Philly, are so hungry for young talent that they're buying startups just for the people. And the amounts are astounding. It comes out to $1.5 million per engineer. So imagine that, right? I mean, it's kind of hard to see because we're all like, you are struggling students, right? But a lot of you are worth $1.5 million each in an acquisition, in an acqui-hire. So absolutely, because those skills that you develop for your startup, those people get acquired and they end up being or working at a large company. Those roles and those skills are very transferable. Great question. Yes?
So I've never spent $5 million in 12 months, but can you share where that, some of the main chunks of where that money goes to?
Wow. Another great question. So the question is, if you had to spend $5 million in 12 months, where does it go? This is a jackass answer, but it's true. It goes into $1,000 Aeron chairs. Everyone gets one. Everyone gets a new MacBook. Everyone gets a good-looking admin, whether that's a guy or a gal. And you get older people, right? So in 2004, that meant we hired the experienced dad that had been working at Sun Microsystems for 15 years. He still had a BlackBerry on a clip right here. He wore Dockers, right? He came in like, you little shits, you don't know anything, right? You hire a legion of them. You just have to. Because the way they want to bet is that they want to see senior level management come in. And those people are expensive, right? Their base could be $180,000 plus bonus, plus options. If they fly, they're going to fly business class, right? By the way, I'm not saying anything bad about the older senior management. I'm not saying anything bad about older senior management. You need them. You need them, right? So if you look at my board of directors now, they're older people, right? If you look at my board of advisors, one of them is the former Surgeon General of the United States. He's older. And there's a lot of value in he does not wear Dockers or a BlackBerry clip. Ken, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to mention you. But you need them, right, at some point. But that's, you know, partly where the money goes as well, right? You know, when you start your startup, it looks like a small raft full of Navy SEALs. It pivots really quickly, it goes really fast. When you get $5 million, it turns into a 120-foot yacht. For it to even turn starboard, multiple lines of communication, many emails need to be sent, right? Yeah, so that's where the money goes. Yes?
So say you have a great idea for an application or some kind of like IT company. Do you seek money first? Or do you try to design a working prototype first?
Wow, lots of great questions. So the question is, if you feel like you have a great idea, do you seek funding first or do you build it first? You know, it's 50-50. If you're really good at pitching, you can get the money first. There was an mHealth competition, believe it or not, for those that attended, didn't attend, excuse me. The team that won, mostly sophomores, and so I wouldn't encourage them to leave school, but you know, 2.5 weeks they developed their idea. That idea, I would give it a 25% chance of getting funded today, right? And that's a good chance. I mean, those are good odds, right? It's some crazy statistic. It's like 1 out of 5,000 startup ideas get funded. So 25%, that's pretty good. So just, you know, sometimes it just depends on the idea. It depends on the timing of it. If your idea was like some good idea about Oculus Rift, I'd try to get the funding first, just because it's so hot right now, right? All right, how are we doing on time?
We have 15 minutes.
Okay, that was a long hour. Any other questions? Yes.
What about getting funding for nonprofits?
Funding for nonprofits. Okay, so the question from Seth Rogen in the back was, I love those glasses. was funding for a nonprofit, can you get it? No. I have a friend that, you know, they have a type 1 diabetes nonprofit, and he actually did raise $1.5 million for it, but he's also the co-founder of TiVo. Actually, are you guys even old enough to know TiVo? You guys know TiVo, okay. He's a co-founder of TiVo. So he made his investors lots of money. So it was kind of like a, you know, gift, right? Not to say that the company doesn't have good legs, I think they do, but it's very, very difficult to get funding for a nonprofit. Okay? Yes? Oh, it's going to be a tough question. Wow, great question. The question was, is there a difference that we see in young entrepreneurs between arrogant and confident? Honestly, no. It's hard to say. You know, last night at dinner, we were talking about a friend of mine who made a fast $4 million, like fast. literally developed this product in a year and sold it. You know, made a few million bucks. I love him to death, but you know, he, I guess others, not I, would call him a bit arrogant. He spent a lot of money. I mean, a lot. Imagine all the ways you could spend that money in a year, and he did. And not for other people, like for himself. And he went almost bust. It was very humbling for him. Now his new startup is kind of blowing up again. Like he won Shark, he won more money on the show Shark Tank than anyone had before. He is now running a Mark Cuban company, and now he's back to what he was before. You know, I don't know. Sometimes I think arrogance kind of drives you. You have to have a supreme confidence in yourself. And I think one of the things that I've seen be a really good kind of grounder, I just made that word up, but for folks that are in a startup is to marry well or have a good partner, right? And I don't mean financially well. I mean someone that has a lot of emotional intelligence and is super supportive of you. The single guys and gals whose startups blow up and they cash out, you know, it's weird. I saw this documentary about lottery winners, and actually it didn't turn out that great for most of them. And I see that a lot with folks that have a successful startup, right? Like, so I thought, you know, gosh, when I sell my first company or I achieve some level of success, right, like all the cute girls that rejected me, and there were many, right, are gonna regret it. I'm gonna like drive fancy cars, and I'm gonna tell my old boss to go F himself, driving around and around in his house, right? And you think of all these things. And it turns out, not only is it incredibly petty, obviously, but when you get there, you have a different set of values, right? The car gets old, you fall in love with some great guy or gal. And none of those things really matter. The people in this game that I've seen be the most grounded, whether you're arrogant or humble, or you switch back and forth between, depending on your fortunes on the roller coaster ride of a startup, having a good partner really, really helps. Yeah. There's a famous, and I'll end with this, there's a famous investor named Bill Joy. And the one advice he gives all of his startup entrepreneurs is marry well. Kind of odd, right? It's not like business advice or tech advice. It's marriage advice. Marry well. Right. Yeah. All right, well, thank you guys. You guys have been an incredible audience. Thank you so much. It's great to be here.